village, that would be a lot better than four. Four is not going to give you anything as far as the village model. Okay? Especially because you have this kind of spatial cloud. If you had 100 clinics reporting cases to you, and if the people who went to those clinics predominantly came from those villages, then we have some chance of doing some things. And in fact, some of what I've just shown you is based on that sort of sample. There's always the problem of, you know, I went to visit my brother 100 kilometers away, I came back home, felt bad, went to the clinic. So that is essentially a presence point that can be very confusing to in a modeling class as a part of it. What I would like, it's not going to be feasible in a lot of situations, but in some situations, we can imagine capturing patient-specific information at the point of the physician or the diagnosis. Because if you look at the information content in the record, start with the patient who's feeling bad, right? The patient knows what he or she has been doing over the past week or 2 weeks or month or whatever. As soon as the patient goes home, dies, and it's just the physician, the information content drops massively. And then the physician who actually talked to the patient, the physician types up a report and it gets submitted to some central office. The information drops again. And so you can imagine this massive leakage of information out of the system. So the more that you can push back to the original patient, or as close to that patient as you can, your data quality improves massively. So what I can imagine is something, you know, phone-based or hand-based, where a physician can say, you know, so how about, what have you been doing for the last week before you started feeling bad? And you say, oh, I just stayed in my home. Or you say, no, I went to visit my brother, and then I went to the Capitol, and then I came home. Okay? So it's not going to happen right away, but that sort of reporting, at least for certain groups of diseases, would be a qualitative improvement in the data space. Okay, so the question is about the environmental variables of what I've been showing you. In the stuff that was done at continental scales, it's the exact same data as you can do. It's climatic data, but not microclimate data. Okay? It's just these broad summaries of seasonal temperature, seasonal precipitation, things like that. For these last couple where we're focusing more regionally, what I've been using is remotely sensed data. And the spatial resolution is between 250 meters and a kilometer. And what those data express is surface reflectance of parts of the electromagnetic spectrum. So essentially, it's a view of greenness across the landscape. And what we do is we load in multiple months. And so we see these kind of seasonal profiles of greenness. And so a lot of what it reflects is a combination of land use and vegetation phenology. Okay, essentially, a rainforest is going to look like this, a desert is going to look like this, all the ground, and a seasonal forest is going to go like this, and then the rains. You have, in your USB keys, you have one of those data sets. It's titled ADHRR. It's an older satellite that gave you some data from the 1990s. The spatial resolution is 1 kilometer. It's a very informative data set. Okay? Ideally, as we improve these approaches, we'll also improve the environmental data sets. And so that means exploring a lot more remote sensing products. They're products that get at soil characteristics, vegetation strength,
the cassava mosaic disease and the cassava ground spread disease. But now I have a challenge of how to do this, because we have the two diseases. We have the host, which is the host for the white line, which is supposed to be the vector. So I don't know how to go about it, because even amongst the hosts, we have different levels of susceptibility. We have different cassava varieties which are susceptible differently. So that's the puzzle that I want you to have. We can map this first in the country and maybe extrapolate to the region. The other question is related to a paper that you did with ENM. It's about BI, back to surveillance in the world. And I was looking at this paper, looking at the distribution of the instance points that you used, and it's related to the last example. So almost 80% of the samples were taken from Tanzania, maybe Kenya, and a few from West Africa. But when you look at the prediction, it predicts that the best area to be in the center somewhere, I think in Congo. I tried to run the same data yesterday with Max, picking out some of the points that, like you say, we don't have predict points. And my predictions show something almost opposite of what we got there. And I've been wondering, what would be the, maybe I did select the some parameters that you use that time. Yes.
Going
to
reverse order. For the Bactrocera study, if I remember right, our predictions are based on so what we were getting was like that that mosquito example I gave you, where you take the native range, you calibrate your model, and you transfer the model to the area of interest. Okay? Now, it's a very good perspective to have the native range view of the world, for example, Africa, and the invaded range view of the world. This is a situation where and becomes really critical. Let's imagine this is an East African region, so it gets to start here. So you get a lot of points documented. In theory, the invasion could really just cover all of Africa. But it starts in East Africa. Okay? And so if you're not controlling carefully your hypothesis of M, then it looks like something that's restricted to East Africa. Climates, which is going to be warm, tropical, but highly seasonal, right? And so, for example, we might leave out the Congo. But it's because if you didn't control M carefully, then the Congo is taken as areas of absence. When in reality, your species may be able to spread across the whole region. So, what we, this essentially referring to a concept so imagine within a given region has the species spread out and colonize all or nearly all of the suitable areas. That would be distributional equilibrium. And that's a situation that's much easier to handle than distributional disequilibrium. Because that says that maybe there's just one individual in Zanzibar. That species arrived in Africa. Maybe it was two individuals in Zanzibar. Eventually, the species is going to spread quite broadly. But at that moment, it has an ecological niche that gives it considerable potential on the continent. You already know that because now it's invaded broadly. And yet, it's fulfilled almost none of that potential because we're so early in the process. Okay? So it's getting massively out of this distributional equilibrium. And that will be a big, big challenge for the modeling attempts based on data. So what I would do in that situation, if I would go back to that situation, is I would get a native range perspective. I would test to see whether the invaded range data disagree with the native range perspective. That's essentially the sort of test with completely independent data that Richard is proposing to become. And then I would attempt to build a native very general bit of advice would be to assemble as many perspectives on it as you can. So certainly mapping of cassava, ideally mapping of varieties across the region would be very useful. Mapping the vector, and mapping the known cases. Okay? So that gives you part of a component-based approach, the vector, and the host, cassava. And it gives you a black box approach. And so you can, if you have all of that information, you have a fairly deep set of evidence about that disease system. And then I personally would sit and look at those maps for a long time, kind of comparing where they agree, where they disagree. For example, look at the distribution of cassava cultivation, look at the distribution of cases of this pest, and ask, why is it not there? Why has it not gotten to this region? Is it still invading? Is that related to the vector? Is that related to the variety? You know, I spend a lot of time just staring at these things along the way because I want to understand the system and not simply rush through it. So those would be some initial steps. Other questions? So the question is, does this apply to situations where it's essentially humans only, no vector involved, no other host, essentially non-zoonotic diseases? I think the answer to your question is no. But if you can envision an environmental influence on that transmission event, okay, so the example that comes to mind might be influenza. Okay? Imagine I have influenza virus and I cough. And you three guys all get influenza. Right? So in theory, that virus only cares that I'm alive and that you're alive. Right? Because it's pretty happy inside of the human body. So in that sense, you might think, no, influenza is not going to be governed by anything environmental. Well, it turns out that for the virus particle to get from me to you as I cough, actually does have an environmental component. And that's one of the major explanations for the seasonal nature of influenza at high latitudes in the temperate zone. So I think my answer to you is yes and no. Some diseases that appear to be essentially just human to human may actually have environmental dimensions to them, and you should be able to at least test to see whether that has environmental correlates that you can measure. But there are certainly a lot of diseases where these techniques are just not appropriate. Okay? Okay. So it's a matter of testing. I did one very detailed paper on bovine tuberculosis in western Mexico. And I tried and found absolutely no environmental signal that had anything to do with where cows were infected with bovine. It depends on the disease system, and you can always propose a hypothesis and test it.
Okay?
Regarding this example down the TV, okay, there are pieces where they give the vaccine, okay, BCG. Can I consider this effect? It's not an environment effect. Can I add this as a layer where there are centers for giving the vaccine?
I think that in the schema that I showed you, that would be part of the filters. Okay, that would be between true incidents or true potential incidents and what actually manifests itself in data as cases. To the extent that those programs are geographic, which is to say, if you can say, yes, this entire village got vaccinated and those five entire villages did not, then I think you have the potential to include that as a predictive layer. So you can kind of play with whether that should be part of generating a true incidence pattern or part of filtering between the true incidence pattern and, you know, kind of the realized incidence pattern. Okay? But, you know, nobody has explored those ideas from a niche modeling perspective. Certainly they have from a spatial epi perspective. So where that should best enter? Then you could essentially mask the parts of the vector